tens of millions of dollars to make, it's movie budgets. And I don't see how you could recover those tens of millions of dollars without some reasonable compromise. I do not think it lasts the last 90 years, thank you very much. But I think you need some limited support for that. One thing that's very interesting is that we've been successful in convincing other companies who have been in the mode of thinking they have these, you know, super valuable proprietary rights in their software to open source their software to use Flask for their products. Most notably, Praxis, a company that deals with proof tools and high integrity software. They produce, it's a dialect of Ada with complete support of proof tools. And here's an interesting example of their technology in action. The air traffic control system that's being written and deployed now, it's starting to be deployed in England, is written in Ada completely, but there's a formal mathematical proof that it's completely free of integer overflow anywhere in there, and it's completely free of what C programmers would call buffer overrun. And there's a mathematical proof for the whole application that that is the case. Impressive. Impressive use of formal tools on a practical scale. And the other thing is SoftCheck, which actually part of AdaCore, but this was before they reacquired them as part of AdaCore, has a sample analysis tool called, which we call Cope here. And that, again, is, you know, millions of dollars have been invested in this proprietary software. We convinced them to open source it. I mean, we will not deal intimately with a company unless they're opening and sourcing their stuff. It's just too much confusion. We don't mind the fact that there are proprietary companies producing proprietary products that work with our software. We don't, you know, say, oh, we won't have anything to do with you, you know, get behind me. We're not in that mode. We're in the mode of saying, sure, we'll give you a copy of our software, we'll support your use for it, and it's just fine if you can make our tools work on our software. Jolly Dean, good for our users, good for us, good for you, and we encourage that. If you go to our site, you'll see a whole lot of partners who are definitely not in the free software business. Most notably, Wind River, you know, our major strategic partner, and it's always interesting when I go on. When I go on talks with Wind River to major customers, I have to kind of tone down my floss comments because I've got this guy next to me who's selling software that comes with exceedingly annoying license server restrictions and license keys that drive absolutely everyone, including all people who are completely berserk. But you know, we certainly think our model could be used much more widely. As I say, I'm not sure it's a recipe for getting mega rich, but you know, one of the things Stallman would always say, that, well, not clear that anyone needs that, or has a right to that, or that it should be a model. I mean, what you want to see in setting up a company is that you can bring in a revenue stream that can support a good group of people with good salaries, and everyone can make a living and have a good time working on interesting software. I think the fact that the software is open so everyone can see your work is a plus. And it's worked really well for us, and it's not that model we would revisit. And more specifically, it's worked really well for our customers. So, you know, that, if someone says, well, why use a free software approach? It's good for our customers. And you know, good companies are interested in doing what's good for their customers. That's always that customer-centric view. So it's really a customer-centric view rather than an ideological point of view that drives us. Although, you know, we certainly understand and appreciate and work with the ideological viewpoint, and we might not be a perfect example of the utopian world of no restrictions at all, but it's a nice step in that direction, and it's a step that can be, you know, for anyone who's in on the knife edge, shall I take out a bunch of patents and make this proprietary, or shall I go the floss route? I think we're little bit of a helpful inspiration to go the fast route, and you know, things are done little by little. So I appreciate the chance to give this talk at what I know is a very technical conference. I mean, you know, I know the next talk will be on some detailed stuff on the optimization of some parts of GCC, and that's what we're here to discuss. But I really appreciate the chance to give a little bit of a different perspective on this, and I'm around if you have questions. I don't know, there's time for a few questions.
We can take a couple of questions now.
Yes. Oh. Have you ever been approached by customers who are already clued in about free software?
Oh yes, absolutely. I mean, we have customers for whom that's a real plus now, and who are definitely know the story, and especially the technical people. You know, the lawyers, well, you know, they take a little bit longer. But no, I think people really understand that it's a plus. Yes, back.
One of the differences in strategy here is that there's a focus on support of our new development.
I would say that we're very much, you know, yes, the support is important, but yes, the new development is important. The new development is really important because, you know, remember, if you say at the end of the year, oh, we don't need to pay all this money to Ada, or we've got the software, we can do our own support, what the heck, we know what we're doing. You won't get the new versions, and we run fast. I mean, one of the things that's very pleasing to me in our company is, I know companies, when they get up to a certain size, can't do anything anymore when it comes to development. We can do very rapid development. We have new technologies. Every version comes out with giant lists of interesting new features. And people, and most, this year is a good example. The latest version has a full implementation of Ada 2012, a language I commend to your attention. Very interesting. It's got a lot of new features, including a very complete view of contracts, of programming by contract. I can say that phrasing, I can't write it down with the trademark. There's a complete list of, you know, the complete support of preconditions, postconditions, and variants. And we have a very interesting project. Have a look at it on the list on the website called Highlight, which is looking at combining runtime tests of that kind with using such things for basing proof techniques on. Very interesting project, very interesting discussion. Yes, question back.
Something quite interesting with data point, looking at it from the outside, is that for certain features, the commits happen behind your goals. And then, on a regular basis, you will commit new things back into GCC.
Yeah, that's.
Is there a chance that this will be changed somehow in the future so that the developer will be more inclusive?
Well, let's say that's been an issue over the years. I don't think we'll ever reach the point at which our development tree is conjoined with the GCC development tree. We just need more control. And I think other companies that have worked with GCC have found that. However,
so you will control
it. Well, let me just make some more comments. One thing we do now is that we commit very rapidly our changes. So we're rarely more than a couple of weeks behind in our changes. So that's, you know, that old problem of new version of Ada, massive patch dumped on the AFSF. That we've worked, you know, we had a lot of criticisms and problems from that. We worked very hard to avoid that now. Arno Schale, you know, a substantial part of, he's one of the most important people in the company. One of the most important things he does is bring changes up to date. And, you know, Eric Markazoo, I think, is known well to you. He also works very hard on bringing our changes up to date. So we try, all I can say is we're very aware of that problem, and we're really trying to avoid the issues that occurred in the past. We think we're doing much better now, because the changes really do get committed pretty rapidly if you look at Arno's changes. Yes?
Well, your last question.
Okay, that actually feeds into another question that I had in mind in several jobs is, you know, where GCC is frozen in terms of new features, is that a problem for you? I imagine, you know, where you have the 6 months where you can't put in new features into, you know, when it's out of stage one.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we always are distributing a version of GCC that is neither the development version nor the most recent distribution. We can't avoid that because, you know, we're always, we have to have a version of the tree that's perfectly reliable to us. And you know, shocking fact, when people make changes to GCC, making sure the data is not affected in any way not their primary focus. And of course, we understand that completely. And we do appreciate the fact that, you know, Ada's in the tree, so a lot of people will do run the Ada test, and we appreciate that. But still, it's our job to make sure the version of GCC we distribute really is solid, and also our job to make sure that all the patches in that version get into the version. Occasionally we have, there are a couple of cases where the FSF collectively has been unwilling to take one of our changes, and we've negotiated, and there are a couple of still on the table like that. Yeah, that's understandable too. You know, we don't have quite the same goals. So, but generally, all our changes go into the tree, and we're committed to that for GDB and for GCC. So maybe that's a good point on which to stop. Thank you again for the opportunity to talk about.